Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Granta, Best of Young British Novelists 5, selected by Granta magazine, and read by Graeme Armstrong, Emily Barber, Thomas Morris, Jude Owusu, Alex Wingfield, and Kate Winter. Introduction by Sigrid Rousing. This is Granta's fifth edition of the Best of Young British Novelists issue, our once-in-a-decade list of 20 of the most promising writers under 40 living in the UK. These issues have a long gestation. For over a year, editors on the Granta team read and discussed several hundred submissions to compile the shortlist for the judges. Renowned novelists Tash Orr, Rachel Cusk, and Helen Oyeyemi, and critic, essayist, and lecturer Brian Dillon. The deadline for the judges' deliberations was August 2022, to give the authors ample time to write the pieces for this issue. It soon became clear that the submitted works separated into genres, or more loosely, trends. The historical novels, most notably The Parisian by Isabella Hammond and The New Life by Tom Crewe. Speculative fiction, Sophie McIntosh, Julia Armfield, Savat Haseem, Missouri Williams and Alison Rumfitt, and perhaps most distinctly, a number of autobiographical novels about gang culture, all written in the vernacular. Graeme Armstrong, The Young Team, Gabriel Krauser, Who They Was, and Moses McKenzie, An Olive Grove in Ends, all made the shortlist. As did the works of Guy Ghanani, In Our Mad and Furious City, and Mr. Mister, which are more explicitly concerned with the theatre of global violence drawn onto a particular London stage, a council estate, a bus. The former three are novels of masculinity and honour, where violence, beyond its role in the commerce of drugs and robbery, is a force simultaneously tainting and purifying. The characters, mostly boys and young men, seem to be always in motion, moving through decaying environments, inventing codes and gestures, buying, selling, planning, talking. Eliza Clarke's Boy Parts has some affinity with these worlds, with its protagonist's voice of dirty disaffection and thinly veiled disdain. But her alienation is symbolic, static, singular to the point of loneliness. Camilla Gradova's writing too, deadpan, experimental, at times scatological, evokes some of the same atmosphere, as does Lauren Amy Curtis's faintly distorted women, nuns, in the short novel Dolores, which creates a similar juxtaposition, an interrogation of the sullied and the pure. It is a platitude to say that every list reflects the taste of the jurors, but this panel represented a wider range of taste than I had expected. Our ideas of and feel for literary merit diverged quite radically. I hope the final list might be more interesting for it, containing, as it does, a wide range of voices, but still, the dividing line between the writers who made the final list and those who didn't has never felt quite so permeable. I never have much faith in lists in any case, and I think we should acknowledge that a different panel might easily have chosen a different group of novelists. Apart from the shortlisted authors mentioned before, Oyinka Braithwaite, Claire Powell, Nisha Dolan or Kirsty Logan might have been chosen for their works of deceptive simplicity and narrative verve. Daisy Johnson, Aidan Cottrell Boyce, Lauren John Joseph or Shola von Reinhold for their innovation and exuberance, A.K. Blakemore, Fiona Moseley, Barney Norris, James Cahill, Samuel Fisher or James Clark for their serious and polished writing, and Vanessa Onwemezi, Diz Tate, Omar Robert Hamilton, or Daisy Lafarge for their originality. These writers could all have been on the list, and of course there are others too. The judges read and thought about language, intention, originality, characters, structure, plot, and complexity. In our meetings, Rachel Cusk talked about writers' ability, or failure, to control and transcend their own material as an important criterion for inclusion on the list. We discussed authenticity of voice, particularly in relation to the works written in the vernacular. We were interested in experimental writing, but we also felt it was important to include authors who did not necessarily play with language, but whose craft and imagination made them outstanding storytellers. Tash Orr questioned how far we should privilege a text's internal sense or logic in our choices. And Brian Dillon noted the slightly caressing, watery feel of many of the novels on the shortlist, and the hard singularity of others. Helen Oyeyemi, the judge among us perhaps most committed to fiction testing the boundaries of convention, was also interested in whether the writer succeeded in evoking curiosity in the reader. Were we compelled to know what happens next? What does the list tell us about the next generation or the state of the nation? I am hesitant to speculate, particularly since we changed the eligibility criteria for admission, dropping the requirement of a British passport in favour of those who live here and think of this country as home. Five authors on the list, including Eleanor Catton, were born abroad, and Sarah Baum was born in Britain but lives in Ireland. But some common themes still emerge. These writers are millennials, the 9/11 generation. Most of them are too young to have experienced much of the brief period of hope following the end of the Cold War. They grew up affected by harsh threats and counter-threats, terror and the war on terror. The financial crash of 2008, followed by austerity and economic polarization, radical moments followed by disillusion. There are dystopian themes in the novels we considered, but affection for the local is here too. Most notably in the short stories of Thomas Morris, We Don't Know What We're Doing, and Saba Sam's Send Nudes. We noted the struggle to make meaning of hard lives, Yara Rodriguez Fowler and Natasha Brown, and the various attempts to understand the conditions of displacement, or more generally, alienation. Olivia Sudjic, Lauren Amy Curtis, Jennifer Atkins, Anna Metcalf. We were all excited by the more experimental texts, trying to understand and explore the limits of what language and writing can do. Ellie Williams, Derek Owusu, Sarah Baum, Graeme Armstrong, Sarah Bernstein. Some of the writers on the list defy categorization. Eleanor Catton's work is conceptual and imaginative, yet pacey and well-plotted, mixing the historical with the contemporary, and the genres broadly termed literary and thriller. Finally, Kay Patrick's short novel Mrs. S was a revelation. Like Maggie Nelson's The Argonauts, a hybrid memoir essay on queer identity, it simply and tenderly returns to the question of love, what it is and what it feels like. To the judges, thank you. I am grateful for your company, your commitment, your diligence and your insight. To the publishers and agents who engaged with this process, thank you. To all the Granta editors, Luke Nimer, Rachel Allen, Josie Mitchell, Eleanor Chandler, Lucy Diver and Brody Krellin, who took on the extra burden of reading and logistics. Chairing those editorial meetings has been a privilege and a pleasure. Most of all, thank you to all the writers, whether they were on the final list or not. Writing is a mysterious thing, marks on the page evoking images in the minds of others, but it has given me and many others the backbone of our lives, our work, our culture, and our own imaginary homelands. Sigrid Rousing.
The Cloud Factory, Graeme Armstrong. There's this photograph of us at Christmas. My granny's wearing a wee sparkly blue cardigan with her hair all done nice. I'm lying in a chair next to her, wearing white trackies and a black polo shirt with the collar up, in a total state. This look had become semi-permanent. I stayed out all night with the young Mavis, stood outside the orange hall, drinking Buckfast out her nut and ecto pills. My ma was annoyed because she didn't want my gran to know about the violence, drugs and madness. I had already been expelled from Airdrie Academy and turned up regularly with broken teeth and black eyes. My old gran wasn't daft. That was one of her last ways. My ma got me a card that said Christmas is a time when you want your past forgotten and your present remembered. I laughed, but felt bad about it. My loving family were collateral damage to all this. The lurie gangs and territorial violence are unstoppable for many young men in Scotland's former industrial heartland, North Lanarkshire. The hallmarks of modern poverty are all around you. Deed high streets are filled with graffitied shutters and tanning salons and bookies and charity shops and off licences and old pishy pubs. The prophetic message, a welcome to hell, was spray painted on the way into my high school in Frash Bush, home to the young Crazy Bush. They fight with the Roy Yardsmans, the young Bundy. You had us, the young Mavis, the GYT for Green Girls, the Win Hoy Obos and Tamil Hill for Gertlee. The young Parnell were for Cairn Hill, the Seahall Toy for Chapel Haw, the Plains Toy, the Crooks Derry, the young Clarkston Derry, the young Rios for Petersburn, the young Bats for Calder Bank, and the young Mob for Craignook. Cope Brig next door was worse, if anything. Down there, you had the RBYT for Red Brig at Cope Brig Sunnyside Station, the Albion Street Fleeto that took in the big flats at Jackson Court and Dunbeth Park, the young Dykes for Sykeside and Green End, the Carnborough Techno next door, and the SYT for Shawhead. The famous Lang El Toy and the young Kirk were all one team for Langlone. Their enemies are for Toonhead, the Paito, the Kaywood Ra for Kirkwood, the Jitto for Glenboig, the young Monks for Old Monkland, the young Shaws for Kirkshaws, and the last before he hit Glasgow, the Bargee Posse for Burgady. The whole place was mapped out and divided among young teams. I came for a good home, but my father dying when I was a wee guy increased my risk tenfold. There was nae immediate reference point for me about what it was to be a Scottish man. Being mental was the chief virtue among these tribes. That became a reality. I was in two gangs, the Young Mavis in Airdrie and the Lang El Toy in Langlone, Cope Brig. Violence was par for the course. I was always fighting with cunts and took a few sore ones. There was a pervasive culture of carrying blades. My ma found a few lockbacks I stashed in my room and flung them on the bin. We sat with the pals at a young murder victim and they were all mad, but still cried for her mate. Taino pulled out a machete on me at the shop, then stowed it away, wrecked out his nut. Down the lane, a wee Jakey walked by the troops and somebody gied him cheek and he whipped a knife out his leather jacket and said, "Yous are no fucking wide now, are yees?" Down the park, Div for the young Dykes pulled a big kitchen devil out and tried to stab our mate. Macintosh for the YM grabbed it off him and flung it down the drain. If he hadn't, Danger Mouse was dead guaranteed. Dell, for my year in school, appeared in a party up our way, and I couldn't stop staring at the slash mark on his face, across his eyebrow, nose and cheek. Ferguson, our mate, got bottled and left like a jigsaw. Two OL toy ones took a knife out our mate's gaff and were going to stab Mai Tai outside Farm Foods. He grabbed his sister's baby and held it until he jumped in a taxi. Me and wee Joe sat in a mad dodgy gaff with a boy who went on to kill. Joe got stabbed 3 times. He was a lucky boy. A mud cunt was after me and said he was going to get me, and without hesitation, I grabbed a long, pointy one with a wooden handle at the cutlery drawer and carried it about for a week in my boy in yellow Bergos jacket. He never showed up in the end, and I'm glad, because at 14, I was probably the most dangerous I ever was. All that was the external violence. The internal revealed itself in the level of substance abuse, isolation, and suicide. Plenty faces we knew hung themselves, and a good few died cause of drugs. We weren't a generation heroin, but it was all around us. I seen Boydy overdose and smack and almost die right in front of us in a gaff. He was all blue and struggling for every breath. I called an ambulance and his best pal Walker pulled the phone cord out the wall while I spoke to the operator. Life is cheap here. I saved Boydy that day, but they both died no long after. We smoked a powder of green.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.